that theme. Now, this work stemmed from a project which I read a book which came out a few months ago, which started as a history of a British company which you may or may not have heard of called Courtauld, which was once the world's largest manufacturer of man-made fibres and now no longer exists. It was taken over and broken up at the end of the 90s. And I was interested in how that had come to pass and to compare its performance and fortunes with other man-made fibre companies, which are listed in this slide here. These are roughly the 15 largest man-made fibre companies in the 1970s. And just to give you a thumbnail sketch of what has happened to this industry since the Second World War, in the first 25 years or so after the Second World War, this industry, making rayon, which is the oldest of the fiber of the man-made fibers, polyester, nylon, acrylic, and other specialized fibers, but mainly those three, big volume fibers, especially polyester, enjoyed a boom. Very rapid growth. All these companies made lots of money out of man-made synthetic fibers during that period. Then came the maturing of the industry, or slowdown of the industry, in the mid-70s. Mainly or partly due to the fact that their biggest customer, the textile industry, was migrating to low-wage countries. So manufacturers in all three regions, Japan, Western Europe, and North America, found their principal customers disappearing, and the industry no longer looked, the man-made fiber industry no longer looked a good one to be in. And so what happened from the 70s, 60s, 70s, 80s onwards, was all these companies had to look for other things to do, or in some cases to use the technology that they'd acquired in the man-made fibre sector to do other things, more advanced things and clever things, which Asian and other low-cost producers couldn't do. And one of the new businesses that is relevant in this context is the carbon fiber story. And I'll explain in a second why that was attractive. Now this carbon fiber, I'm not going into technology, but this carbonization or removal of carbon atoms from fibers has been around for a long time. But the idea of using a carbon fiber as an ingredient in a composite material which had exceptional strength and low weight came to the fore after, well, probably in the 60s and more particularly in the 70s. And these composite materials with carbon fiber as the kind of reinforcing agent came to be used in the aerospace industry, in sporting goods, and in a whole lot of other industrial applications. It was used in the US by Union Carbide and others for the space program and for military applications, and there was an active research effort in other parts of the world. And this carbon fiber manufacturing process starts with a precursor material which is then carbonized, and different processes take place, and ultimately you get these very strong composite materials. The precursor material that was used at the start was rayon, but it was found in that acrylic fiber was the most suitable precursor for this material. And so it was an obvious opportunity for acrylic fiber producers who were struggling because their textile customers were disappearing. Here was a new market, not vulnerable to competition from low-wage countries, which looked attractive. So Courtauld, which was a big acrylic fiber producer in Europe, Toray, a big acrylic producer in Japan, and others, got interested in carbon fiber. DuPont, which was by far the most innovative and successful of the man-made fiber processes, decided against going into carbon fiber because they had developed their own different high-strength material, you know, this stuff called Kevlar, which is used in bulletproof vests and things like that. So, looking at the different countries that were active, important advances were made in the UK by a government research agency called the Royal Aircraft Establishment, which was looking for lighter materials to go into aircraft. And that they found that acrylic fiber was a good precursor for their process. They licensed several companies in the UK to use their process. There was tremendous enthusiasm in the UK when the RAE announced these developments, people thought this was going to be the most important material since steel, and it was going to give a great boost to British industrial strength. Unfortunately, the end of the 60s, Rolls-Royce, which was its big customer for carbon fiber, used it in a new engine called the RB211, and this engine with turbine blades made from carbon fiber collapsed under a bird. There was a bird impact test, and they had to abandon that design and replace carbon fiber with titanium. And that was a big setback and sort of a disappointment for people who'd had high hopes for carbon fiber. However, Courtauld and the others thought, rightly, that the aerospace market was a big potential outlet, and the US had by far the biggest aerospace industry, so they started looking for partners in the US that would enable them to attack the US market. Courtauld partnered with Hercules, which is a kind of defense contractor, advanced materials producer. So, and Courtauld was the leading European player in carbon fiber in these early days. Japan also, separately, scientists there were making advances, and this man called Dr. Shindo, an important patent, and as I mentioned, these acrylic fiber producers, led by Toure and several others, took it up. They were struggling with the Japanese textile industry in decline, looked like a wonderful opportunity. Of course, the Japanese had no aerospace industry, so they had no local market of that sort as there was in the Europe and the US. And a stroke of luck took place in that somebody, I think it was an American actually, who discovered that carbon fiber golf clubs extended the length of the average golfer's drive by 40 or 50 yards. Japanese crazy about golf, as you know, and they tend to be smaller than Americans, and they took up carbon fiber golf clubs with huge enthusiasm. I think there was one of the Americans won the Japan Open using a carbon fiber golf club, and that helped to give a boost to the sporting goods market. And another piece of luck, I might say, the world's biggest sporting goods manufacturers were in Taiwan and South Korea. And so Japan was very well placed to supply those two countries, the manufacturers in those two countries, with carbon fiber. And they invested, especially Toure, but Topo Rail was the second one, and they knew that or saw that there were going to be other industrial and aerospace applications, so they invested ahead of demand, improved their technology, made links with Americans who wanted to build up their carbon fiber business, and in particular, and this was a very significant event, Toure got an order from Boeing for secondary structures in one of their airliners at the end of the 70s. And the US, interestingly, was not the leader in carbon fibre technology and relied on partnerships and, to some extent, imports of the material from their European or Japanese partners. Now, these partnerships changed a bit during the 1980s, and the market was slow to develop. As with most advanced materials that are designed to replace conventional materials, usually it takes much longer to break into these markets than initially seems possible. So, and I think probably some of these partner changes reflected this slow growth of the market, and some of the Americans got out of the business. Courtauld's partnership with Hercules went sour. Hercules complained that the Courtauld's fibre had impurities which made it difficult to get into the aerospace market, which was the most demanding market, the most profitable market, but the most difficult to break into. They dropped that arrangement with Hercules was dropped. Courtauld's made another found another American company to partner with. They built a plant in Sacramento, California, and continued to plug away at the US market while also supplying the sporting goods market through a Japanese partner. Axo, which is another big European fiber maker, came into the business with Tobo Rail. So the market did move ahead quite fast during the 1980s, mainly reflecting the build-up of American defense industry. And as you can see, the US was by far the largest market during that decade. And at the end of the decade, towards the end of the Pentagon, Defense Department was anxious about the dependence of the US defense industry on these foreign suppliers, and imposed a requirement that at least 50% of carbon fiber and composite materials should be manufactured in the US. This prompted a big wave of investment in new capacity in the US. Then comes the end of the Cold War, the detente, big reduction in US Defense Department orders, a huge setback for the carbon fiber industry. And this is a critical moment, and this is the critical moment. Most of the companies in the US and Europe pulled out. Courtauld sold its Sacramento plant to Mitsubishi Rayon in the Japanese company and closed down its plant in Coventry. Axo withdrew, BASF got out, and so on. The ones that continued to invest during this so-called detente recession were the Japanese. Even though profitability was very low and the market was depressed, they continued to invest in R&D to try to develop new applications for carbon fiber. And this just to illustrate the extent to which the market fell in the early 90s. And if you just look at the aerospace line and the USA, the US aerospace market fell back sharply. The other sectors were a bit more stable. So the Japanese continue to invest patiently in the development of their carbon fiber business. And when the market recovered in the late 1990s, they were in a very strong position to get a larger share of the market, and they have continued to dominate the world market.
Can I just ask for clarification? When you say that they continue to invest, this is private investment? Those are purely private?
Purely private investment.
What are they?
Purely private investment. There's no government involvement or whatever. It's a private enterprise thing. So, as you can see, over this 20-year period, of course, Toray and Toho Rayon were important players back in the end of the 80s, but by the end of the 2000s, the three Japanese, especially the top two, were the dominant supplier. So, and the carbon fibre market has continued to expand. These forecasts, I think, were taken before the financial crash, so it may not be quite right, but the important point to note is that, as the Japanese believed, carbon fibre is now more widely used in cars and other products, as well as in aerospace and of course, in sporting equipment, although that's now a smaller part. So, here's the question: why did the Japanese come out on top? And here's an explanation given by one of the senior executives in Tohoku Rayon, the second largest of the Japanese producers. And a very important, although how important is hard to judge, factor is that the Japanese companies, especially Toray and Tohoku Rayon, were less exposed to shareholder pressure than their European and American counterparts. They were part, most of them, were members of the Keiretsu network, which I'm sure you're familiar with, which is a system of cross-shareholdings in a kind of family group, Toray belonging to the Mitsui group, so they were never exposed to takeover, or indeed to shareholder pressure that might have said, you know, why are you persisting with carbon fibre when the returns are so low? So, here comes the central question as to how important these national institutions, the absence of shareholder pressure, the absence of the takeover threat, how much weight to give to that factor, as opposed to other factors, such as Toray made better carbon fibre than anybody else because they had superior technical ability or technical success, you might say, and they were much better able to tap into Airbus and Boeing markets than, for example, Cortex. They had good luck in that the golf club market and then later tennis rackets, fishing rods and other sporting equipment came along at a critical moment, and the fact that they had close links with Taiwan and Korea. So, sort of reluctant to overstate the lack of shareholder pressure, but it's certainly a factor. Worth noting that two European companies, BASF and Akzo Nobel in the Netherlands, neither of which were exposed to takeover pressure in the sense that, in the way that Cortex was, also pulled out. It was a difficult market. So it does seem to be then, we can look at it as a triumph of Japanese long-termism. But you've got to look at the other side of the Japanese system. There was another fiber manufacturer which played its cards extremely badly. It diversified into businesses which it didn't make a success of. Was very slow to get out of those businesses, and eventually had to be rescued. This is Kanebo. And here's another quote from somebody who was brought in to rescue Kanebo when it bust. And he saw the Kanebo disaster as an example of the weakness of the Japanese system, that companies stick with bad businesses for too long. So that's, as it were, the other side of the Japanese story. Now, in recent times, I'm talking about the last 10 years or so, yes, maybe more than that, early 90s, the Japanese system, Japanese business system, like, has got modified, has changed, in that there's been more involvement by foreign investors, Anglo-American investors, who have pushed Japanese companies to focus more narrowly on their better businesses. Some of the intercompany shareholdings have been, the Keiretsu system that I mentioned, some of those intercompany shareholdings have been unwound. So that there is, in many Japanese companies, I think, a much greater responsiveness to shareholder pressure than there was before. And so I suppose you could, and maybe Germany has some parallels with Germany here, Japan has been evolving towards a more hybrid system, which retains some of this long-termist element that I've been mentioned, but is more conscious of shareholder value, more conscious of the need not to persist too long with loss-making businesses. So it may be then that you've got this hybrid system. This is just speculation, and which retains some stakeholder long-termist aspects, and perhaps is especially suited for industries like the carbon fiber one that I described, which are where the demand is a bit erratic, which take a continuous incremental investment in R&D and in improving the manufacturing process. And those sorts of businesses, in which Toray is now overwhelmingly the world leader, are better suited for the Japanese system, whereas industries which are more turbulent or characterized by more disruptive technological changes, they are less successful at. But that's important.
I think that the, when we think about the Japanese, is that they, although Westerners experience them in terms of the products, the cars and, you know, and various types of products, it was always process in Japan that allowed them to dominate. And so I think this is a continuation of this, except it's less visible because we don't buy it. We buy the product, we don't buy the carbon fiber. And, but it's, you know, there's so many, I think this continues to be a great strength of the Japanese, and I think they're right, that where it's a question of just continuing to invest in some basic technology, you need these kinds of organizations. Actually, you see the same thing in China. I mean, state-owned enterprises are the ones that are investing in very capital-intensive, stable industries where the product isn't changing all the time. The non-state-owned sector is the one where it's evolved to you know, basically are firms that are much more flexible in terms of the market, in terms of you know, directly accessing new models of this and that. The thing about the changes, which I used to know, because I haven't been in Japan a long time. But the Japanese, I mean, there was a structure that kept the shareholders at bay. And in the late, when they had financial big bang in 1997, the American investment banks in particular expanded in Tokyo like vultures, ready to grab all this money out of companies and started spouting the shareholder value and stuff. But the actual regulation under financial big bang was kept the internal economy totally regulated and was trying to then get higher returns through asset management from the global economy, not from the internal economy. And I experienced this, it was 1999 when I was at INSEAD, when there was a small group of us went to talk to an organization called Keizai Doyukai, which is a kind of a debating society of top executives. And the previous leader had been someone who was pushing shareholder value. And but it was quite clear that after financial big bang, because of the presence of Merrill Lynch and Goldman Sachs and all these the corporate executives realized, hey, this is a little scary, we're not going to control this. And there was a complete reversal to argue that, you know, we needed something that was much more of a stakeholder system, and they were quite aware of it. And the other side of it was, I think, the increased foreign shareholding, which increased quite dramatically, was in part because the banks, it was the banks that got into trouble because they tried to pretend that the banks were actually profit-making enterprises when they were really, the banks were Japan's developmental state, from my point of view. And the last thing is that when I was following this more closely, I was about, you know, takeovers and the kinds of things you see, particularly in the United States, but to some extent in Europe. What struck me was if you looked at this, the first half of the 2000s, if you looked at the Japanese economy, there was one guy within Japan who was a raider. His name was Murakami, and his guy would appear again and again until finally, I guess the government and the Japanese elite said, hey, this guy is a bit of a pain. Other people might try to follow up on him. So they got trumped up some charges on him and got him, you know, out of the game. I mean, the last thing is that I did have also an experience which in the mid-90s there was a company called Yokogawa Electric, which was actually majority owned by GE, and GE had kept a bigger stake in it. And GE was trying to control it, and the way the Japanese dealt with that was, we were talking to the CEO, who was Japanese, and I asked him, did you ever have any Americans in top management positions here? And he said, oh yeah, there was this guy here, but he left after the scandal. And the scandal was that Japanese, the Tokugawa Electric, which was selling medical equipment, GE medical equipment, was bribing the hospitals. Well, they bribed the hospitals all the time. They wanted to get rid of them, so they created a scandal that was his responsibility, and they brought in Japanese management. So there was a way of dealing with it.
Thank you very much. I mean, one of the things that struck me in your talk was the parallels with this industry and the supercomputer industry.
Supercomputer?
Where you had a similar kind of situation where British military technology being very, very important, you had British capability, then 1987, you had domestic sourcing in the US, killed off that market, and a section of the technology went over to Japan. The Americans continued a very strong focus on high performance, and the mass market was picked up in Asia. And to a large extent, the Brits dropped out of the picture. So I think there's parallels across a number of industries here. One thing I would want your views on, the 1987 domestic sourcing introduction, that came in parallel with a shift in the nature of US military procurement. From we will be bigger than everyone else to we will be bigger than everyone else and we will be the best. So it's the introduction of technological superiority driving military doctrine. And that shifted the nature of innovation far more towards performance than its previous focus had been on how much stuff can we just get out. So there'd be more focus on kind of the scale of production, which potentially might have changed how patterns of innovation specialized around the world, which would have left the Brits very, very exposed in that they were stuck with an old, inappropriate innovation pattern in a world that had changed. Do you have any comments on that?
I probably don't know enough detail about that. My impression is that the 87 ruling was a straightforward, we are at risk because we are too dependent on stuff coming in from Europe and Japan, and so it was a kind of self-sufficiency type of decision rather than a technological superiority.
It was in the context of
what had been going on at the same time. I don't think, from what I've understood, I don't think that, to your point, I don't think applies to the carbon fiber story, but it may have.